What is heart failure? What are the symptoms and how do we treat it? This and more in this video. Have fun and enjoy. Congestive heart failure is the state when the heart cannot pump blood sufficiently to meet the demand of body tissues. There are two pathological mechanisms, systolic and diastolic dysfunction. Systolic dysfunction means abnormality of heart contractions. If ventricular filling is impaired, this state is called diastolic dysfunction. Stroke volume is the volume of blood which is squeezed out with each heart contraction. It's the difference between end-diastolic volume and end-systolic volume. Ejection fraction is an important index that well describes systolic function. It's equal to stroke volume divided by end-diastolic volume. In the case of systolic dysfunction, the ejection fraction is reduced. It is due to impairment of ventricular pumping function. In the case of diastolic dysfunction, the ejection fraction is normal, but stroke volume may be decreased. It is due to increased ventricular wall stiffness and ventricle cannot be normally filled. During diastole, ventricle receives less volume of blood and respectively it pumps small amount of blood. According to the Frank-Starling law, stroke volume increases in response to increase in end-diastolic volume. Large volume of blood flow into the ventricle leads to stretching of cardiac muscle fibers resulting in an increase in the force of contraction. Heart failure is considered to be caused by any condition reducing the efficiency of myocardial work. The common cause of heart failure is ischemic heart disease, which results in myocardial scar, myocardial stunning or hibernation, and endothelial dysfunction. Other causes include valvular heart disease, arrhythmias, sick sinus node, conduction disorders, pericardial effusion, toxic damage by alcohol, amphetamine, cocaine, anabolic steroids, and heavy metals. As well as some drugs, as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, anesthetics, thiazolidine ions, cytostatics, interferons, and monoclonal antibodies. Congenital heart diseases, for example, hypertrophic, dilated, restrictive cardiomyopathy, non-compaction syndrome, muscular dystrophies. Infection, especially Chagas disease, HIV, and AIDS. Autoimmune disease, malignancy, amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, hemochromatosis, endocrinal disorders, and renal failure. Common symptoms of patients with heart failure include breathlessness, ankle swelling, nocturnal dyspnea, and fatigue. Symptoms are related to buildup of fluid in the tissues and veins of different parts of the body. According to clinical symptoms and signs, the congestive heart failure may be either right-sided or left-sided or biventricular. Left-sided heart failure is characterized by breathlessness, cyanosis, rails or crackles, gallop rhythm, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, nocturnal cough, dizziness, poor exercise tolerance. Backup of blood in the pulmonary veins and capillary beds of lungs leads to increase in the blood pressure in the pulmonary artery, resulting in moving of fluid from blood vessels to interstitial space, causing pulmonary edema. At first, fluid migrates to interstitial space, then it moves into the alveoli, impairing oxygen and carbon dioxide exchange. Patients usually use 3 or more pillows to reduce nocturnal dyspnea. Right-sided heart failure is characterized by ankle edema, elevated jugular venous pressure, hepatosplenomegaly, and ascites. In this case, blood moves back into the right atrium and vena cava, causing congestion in the veins of the systemic circulation. Blood moves to interstitial space of liver, spleen, and legs. It can cause hepatosplenomegaly, cardiac cirrhosis, and pitting ankle edema. Pressure of the blood in the veins of the lower limbs increases when patients take long-term sitting or standing positions due to gravity, and edema reduces when patient takes lying down position. The fluid from interstitial space migrates into the peritoneal space leading to ascites. Current classification of heart failure is based on ejection fraction. Heart failure with reduced ejection fraction when ejection fraction is less than 40%, heart rate failure with mid-ranged ejection fraction when ejection fraction ranges from 40 to 49%, and heart rate failure with perceived ejection fraction when ejection fraction is 50% and more. Also, diagnosis of heart failure with preserved or mid-range ejection fraction requires elevated levels of natriuretic peptides and structural heart disease, for example, left ventricular hypertrophy and/or left atrial enlargement, or signs of diastolic dysfunction. Natriuretic peptides are considered to be elevated when BNP is more than 35 picograms per milliliter and or NT-proBNP exceeds 125 picograms per milliliter. Functional classification according to the New York Heart Association involves four classes. Class 1 denotes no limitation of usual activity. Class 2 means mild limitation of activity, when patient is comfortable at rest or with mild exertions. Patient belongs to class 3 when there is limitation of any activity and patient is comfortable only at rest. Class 4 concerns with patients which have symptoms at rest and are uncomfortable at any physical activity. There are four stages of heart failure according to American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association. Stage A means the patient is at high risk for heart failure development, but at this moment has no functional or structural heart disorders. Stage B means that there is structural heart diseases without symptoms. Stage C concerns the patients with structural heart disorders and symptoms of heart failure. Patients with stage D require hospital-based support, mechanical circulatory support, heart transplantation, or palliative care. Diagnosis is based on echocardiography. It allows to measure left ventricular end-diastolic volume, ejection fraction, stroke volume, and to find out signs of diastolic dysfunction. Systolic dysfunction is diagnosed when ejection fraction is less than 40%. Signs of diastolic dysfunction are based mainly on transmitral blood flow. E-to-A ratio is very important. The E-peak arises due to an early diastolic filling. The A-peak arises due to atrial contraction. Normally, E-to-A ratio ranges from 0.8 to 2. There are following stages of the diastolic dysfunction. Stage 1, called impaired relaxation when E-to-A ratio is less than 0.8. Stage 2, called pseudo-normalization when E-to-A ratio ranges from 0.8 to 2 or E-to-A ratio is less than 0.8. An E-peak exceeds 50 cm per second. Stage 3 is called restrictive when E-to-A ratio exceeds 2. To differentiate normal E-to-A ratio and stage 2 diastolic dysfunction, three following criteria should be evaluated. Average E-to-E prime ratio more than 14. Tricuspid regurgitation velocity more than 2.8 meters per second. Left atrial volume index more than 34 milliliters per cubic meter. If 0 or 1 criterion is positive, normal diastolic function or stage 1 diastolic dysfunction is diagnosed. If 2 or 3 criteria present, stage 2 diastolic dysfunction is diagnosed. Also, isovolumetric relaxation time plays an important role. It's the time between the closure of the aortic valve and the opening of the mitral valve. Normally, it is less than 70 milliseconds. Also, deceleration time is important. It's the time from the E-peak to baseline. Normally, it's less than 220 milliseconds. In patients with preserved ejection fraction, 2D speckle-tracking echocardiography often detects impaired global longitudinal systolic strain. ECG may diagnose arrhythmia or conduction disorders that lead to heart failure. Chest X-ray reveals cardiomegaly, which is measured by cardiothoracic ratio, Carley B lines, and pleural effusion. Soluble ST2 is a new laboratory marker of heart failure. Being of cardiac fibrosis marker, soluble ST2 gives ability not only to predict hospitalization frequency and lethality, but also it complements prognostic value of natriuretic peptides. Correction of underlying disease plays the key role in treatment. Sodium restriction diet is recommended. In patients with type 2 diabetes mellitus, sodium glucose cotransport 2 inhibitors can prevent or delay the onset of heart failure. Treatment of patients with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction starts with ACE inhibitor or beta blocker. If patient is intolerant to ACE inhibitor, angiotensin receptor blockers are used, but combination of these agents should be avoided. Carvedilol is preferred in the case of reduced ejection fraction. Treatment with beta blockers starts with minimal dose and is up to titrated to maximum tolerant dose. If ejection fraction remains lower than 35%, mineralocorticoid receptors, angiotensin should be added. If ejection fraction is still lower than 35%, combination of neprilysin inhibitor and angiotensin receptor blockers, sacubitril, valsartan, should be used. If patient's heart rate exceeds 70 beats per minute, Evibrodin should be added to keep heart rate less than 70 beats per minute. If patient presents with sinus rhythm and QRS duration is more than 130 milliseconds, need of cardiac resynchronization therapy should be considered. Diuretics should be used to improve symptoms and signs of congestion. If despite all these measures, symptoms persist, digoxin, hydralazine with isosorbide denitrate should be considered. The last line therapy involves left ventricular assist devices and heart transplantation. Thiazolidine ions, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, diltiazem, and verapamil may deteriorate heart failure. If left ventricular ejection fraction remains less than 35%, despite optimal medical therapy, or patients has history of ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation, and in the case of myocardial infarction, which are at least 40 days after acute myocardial infarction, the cardioverter defibrillator is implanted. For patient with preserved ejection fraction, beta blockers, ACE inhibitor, or angiotensin receptor blocker should be considered. We hope that you liked this video. Feel free to comment, share, like, and to subscribe.